good going people. Of course, we have a lot of local folks coming today, and I'd like to introduce Johnny Axel. That's going to inherit and runners. So please welcome. Thank you.
The 2018 World Series, one of the Los Angeles Dodgers' pitchers produced one of the most intriguing stat lines in postseason history. Despite having a 3.86 ERA and WAR indicating he has saved about 1/5 of a run relative to an average pitcher, he had the third lowest win percentage added amongst any player in the series. He only pitched 1.2 innings and yet managed to be one of the most influential players on the series. Who was him? Who was he? You might know him. Ryan Matson. Now, what caused this massive difference between ERA and WAR saying he did very well, and win percentage added saying that he was an atrocity? He allowed all seven of his inherited runners to score. So WAR and ERA were applauding him for only allowing one earned run, for allowing one run in 2.1 innings pitched, while win percentage added revealed the true damage he caused the Dodgers' chances. And how did I discover this difference between win percentage added and WAR? This spring I was doing a research project about MVPs, and I noticed that league-wide wins above average was not adding up to zero, which means an average player is not equal to an average player. The one thing that needed to happen was above average. I was pretty frustrated, and part of me just wanted to give up on the project. But no. Thankfully, Baseball Reference has a wonderfully in-depth explanation on the WAR formula. So I got a Google sheet open, copied over all the information on pitchers, and just got to work. I was trying to find this mystery component that was leading WAR to not add up right. Now, I ended up being some small adjustment, but it was in this research process of taking every potential oversight, every generalization and concept I just generally didn't disagree with, where I kind of worked out my problem with WAR. I found something that I thought was fundamentally wrong with WAR, and I started working at it to where I could trust WAR myself. See, WAR, the general idea is to take the player's once allowed per nine innings and compare it to what a replacement level player would do in terms of once allowed per nine innings, and then multiply that by playing time. Now, of course, this is incredibly difficult to determine. You know, there are countless adjustments that go into the replacement player's once allowed per nine innings, like what ballpark did they pitch in? What defense did they have behind them? What offenses were they facing? All these factors got done in incredible detail to try to get this as precise as possible. But the golden rule of Baseball Reference's WAR is to never touch the player's runs allowed per nine innings. The thing is, this system relies heavily on runs allowed per nine innings being a solid statistic in itself. But it has the fundamental flaw of relying on pitchers following the pitcher that we're talking about. Now let's imagine I'm pitching the World Series. Pretty cool, but I'm not that great of a pitcher. I leave guys on first and second base with two outs. So technically I haven't allowed the runs to score yet, but I haven't exactly helped the situation, hence why I'm responsible for it. Now Ryan Matson comes in and gives us a three-run home run. Now I've allowed the two runs. But is that really fair? Do I deserve two runs while Ryan Matson just gets the one? When I left the game, in an average scenario, the runner on second has a 22% chance of scoring, and the runner on first has about 13% chance. So when I left the mound, I should have been expected to surrender about 0.35 runs. Had Ryan Madsen gone the guy out, I would have thanked him. He saved me about a third of a run. But in this case, by giving up the home run, he costed me an additional 1 2/3 runs. I had no control over what Ryan Madsen was doing, and yet he held so much into my evaluation, because now my runs allowed for 9 is not looking good. Now, in this proposed system, this new factor, I guess, of war, there are naturally two sides to it, both always canceling each other out. One is inherited runners, in which case Ryan Madsen did not do me justice. And the other, uninherited runners, in which case I got pretty unlucky. Now, where they fundamentally differ is from the perspective of an individual player. From my perspective, when I left the field, I had no control over the uninherited runners. Had the coach brought in Kenley Jansen, maybe I wouldn't be having two runs allowed right now. But regardless, there was nothing I could do. It was out of my control. On the other hand, Ryan Madsen completely controlled what he was doing with the inherited runners I gave him. He gave up those two home runs because he threw a fastball down the middle to Mitch Moreland, which actually didn't happen.
Still going.
Now, uninherited runners, that side factor, is what most of the war is, trying to account for stuff that I, as the pitcher, cannot control. But the inherited runner side is something a bit more interesting. It hints at a potential systematic devaluation of relief pitchers, and specifically their ability to handle inherited runners. Now, that was all one game. Over the course of a season, they generally tend to cancel each other out. But there's naturally going to be variation. There are going to be players that keep getting unlucky, and players that keep getting lucky. So I decided to take a look at just how this goes over a season. Using Baseball Reference's game logs, we took their each player's entering scenario and exiting scenario, and used that to project how many inherited runners allowed to score they could expect, and how many uninherited runners they could allow to expect. Now, by comparing this to their real values of how many runners they allowed to score and how many uninherited runners they had scored, you can start getting an idea of, roughly focusing on inherited runners, how much WAR got their values off. So I decided to sample every pitcher in the 2017, every ERA qualified pitcher in 2017. And here were the results. As you can see, there was quite a bit of variation. Some players even being off by about 4 runs. The average absolute value change in runs above average was 1.5 with a standard deviation of 1.2. So yes, this was a significant factor. I think it costed Max Scherzer 3 runs thanks to the Nats bullpen. But how does this compare with other WAR factors? Because at the end of the day, Sean Foreman and the people at Baseball Reference, they would have to go in and put thousands of lines of code. Is that worth it? Well, I used the same average absolute value change to qualified players to compare my proposed factor to already existing ones. Now, by no means would it be this massive change relative to other WAR factors, but you can see, it holds its own. It's on line with batters grounding into double plays and base running in which field the players play at. But even this bar chart does not quite do this proposed factor's justice. See, with every other factor in WAR, the separation between a player and average increases over time. Mike Trout is a pretty good baseball player in almost every aspect of the game. But how do we know that? Because we've seen seasons and seasons of data from him where he is clearly differentiating himself from an average player. Now, if we take one season and his roughly 10 WAR and we cut it in half, you can expect a WAR of about 5 because of the amount of distance he created from him to an average. average player, as a base runner, as a fielder, as a hitter, it gets halved. But that's not quite the case with the inherited runner spectrum, because the players who pitch the most innings tend to be starters. What this means is those starters are only pitching 30 games, and they never get the chance to handle inherited runners. So relief pitchers, who are pitching 60, 70 times in one season, have 60 or 70 opportunities to inherit runners, to lead runners on base. So despite not pitching the most innings or getting most playing time, they could potentially see the most variation amongst 10 players in the league. So to try to capture this, I went through Baseball Reference's database of relief pitchers in 2017. And I tried to find the outliers. I tried to find guys who were remarkably good at handling inherited runners when, or were absolutely terrible at it. And then running through them through the same system as I had the starters, I started getting an idea of who the most extreme players were. And the results were shocking. So, these were the two extremes of the spectrum. On one hand, Yusmer Petit. In 2017, pitching for the Los Angeles Angels, he was a perfect 20 for 20 in stranding his inherited runners, saving his team about 6.5 runs by doing so. On the other hand, he also left 13 runners on base, and 5 of them came around to score. So the pitchers behind him costed him about 1.4 runs because they didn't handle the runners he gave them very well. So overall, or in terms of speaking of inherited and uninherited runners, messed up his value by about 8 runs. Considering he was only 9 runs above average that season, that means he was about twice as valuable relative to an average player, but then WAR actually indicates. Now on the other hand, we have Heath Henry, and I know as a Red Sox fan, it was difficult to see this, but in 2017, he inherited 46 runners, and he allowed 22 of them to score. So he only stranded players at 52% rate, costing pitchers in front of him 6.5 runs. He also left 25 runners on base. Only 5 of them came around to score thanks to Robbie Scott and Craig Kimbrel following him. So he costed pitchers in front of him 6.5 runs, and he benefited 5 runs by having good pitching following him. So again, in general, WAR messed up his value by about 11.5 runs. But this is all nice, and those relievers really show the potential variation that is not being captured by that bar chart. Shows that it's all legitimate, but I can stand up here and rant about how WAR is just a little bit off. But does it actually get implemented? This fall, I emailed Sean Foreman, and I pretty much proposed the same thing I just did. I laid out why it makes sense in terms of logically and analytically, seeing the absolute value change. It's a good factor. And he proposed something interesting. See, I had proposed it to follow suit with every other WAR factor up till now, where we're affecting that replacement player's runs allowed per 9 innings. You just kind of throw that in, and again, golden rule, do not touch the player's runs allowed per 9 innings. But he said it actually made more sense to fundamentally change how the WAR formula works. Rather than not touching the runs allowed for 9 innings and focusing on the replacement level players, it would actually make more sense to just make a runs allowed for 9 innings based off of the expected runs allowed. So you take the run that player allowed himself, and you take the expected count of when he came out of the game, and then that's how you create your new runs allowed for 9 innings. He was proposing that it could be the only factor on the left side of that work. Now, he said regardless that that was going to be something that they look into this offseason and potentially could be factored of the next WAR update. Now, overall, what does this mean? I'm fine-tuning WAR just a little bit, which is cool. But what does it mean? I could have thrown my hands up last spring when I found that inequality. I didn't like WAR that much at the time, and I very easily could have disregarded it as many MVP didn't. I looked at war and I found parts of it I didn't like. Rather than just disagreeing and turning away, I thought, what could I do to actually improve this? What could I do to make me agree with it? Maybe that's how we should approach everything. If you don't like it, don't just stand there and be mad. Just go out and be the change you want to see in the world, especially when it comes to war. Sure, how the inherited runners carries over that, because their baseball reference is solely focused on the player who runs a lot per nine innings, which, as I said, runs a lot per nine innings is not perfect and it can be affected by other players. I'm pretty sure fielding independent pitching, being based off of walks and strikeouts and home runs, doesn't have the same problem, but no, I focused on baseball reference, and that's just kind of the universe I put myself in.
So, first of all, very nice job, and I'm really glad to see that you reached out to Sean and you're, you know, reaching out, looking at how other people are thinking about this. Because, you know, one of the things that's interesting, you put your finger on one of the, sort of one of the real schisms that's gone on in the conservative community for a long time, which is this question of what do you do with situational statistics within the context of looking at a particular season, right? It's always that trade-off. Are you looking backwards or looking forwards? Mm-hmm. And so a lot of these numbers are pretty small sample sizes. So but they do tell you something about the value of what the player generated beforehand. They aren't necessarily predictive of the future. So those are kinds of things to maybe as you continue to look at this research to think about some of those and particularly take a look at the sample sizes and see, you know, is how much of this is potentially random variation.
Mm-hmm. Well, that was actually one big difference between baseball reference war and Fangraphs war. Because Fangraphs, the reason they based their system off of fielding independent pitching, as opposed to runs allowed per nine innings, is they found that held much more predictive value. So relative to baseball references war, Fangraphs war holds a lot more, you know, insight into the future. And I'm not sure the exact wording, but baseball reference, they said their fundamental goal in producing war was to measure the value of a player relative to replacement. So if you closed your eyes when they entered the game and left the game, it is estimating over the course of a season how much did that player contribute relative to replacement. So you can judge, I guess, if you're okay with that being the way war works, but my goal in this was just making that value how much they contributed is the bid more accurate. Yep.
Did you take any multiple season look? Middle relief pitcher performance is extraordinarily volatile year to year. I'm a Red Sox fan too, and I know for a fact that Pete Henry this year would use exclusively to come in the game with men on base. So, you know, the manager of the World Championship team trusted him to do what he didn't do really well before. But, year to year, those statistics may not hold up, and particularly with relievers, because the highest paid relievers are closers who more often than not come in with the bases empty. This whole group of middle guys that seem to be fungible, get DFA back to the minors. They're the ones who are coming in to put out rallies, to snuff out rallies and get stuff. I just wondered if you look from, you know, year to year, whether these patterns are consistent or just bad luck, because with the small sample size.
Well, I wasn't focusing too much, I guess, on predictive value and seeing how it carried over. So I did generally focus on 2017, but based on some of the guys that were in the top ranks of relief pitchers in terms of how they handled inherited runners, I think it can generally be concluded it is a lot of luck, considering Yusmeiro was one of the best Ogdawa, I think, was third, with Jorge De La Rosa being second. So these aren't necessarily the most elite pitchers. I, of course, was expecting guys like Chad Green and Andrew Miller to be at the top of the list, but it was actually guys who were pretty random.
Yeah.
But it's all, for me, it was all about just fine-tuning the value of what they actually did do.
As opposed to a predicted value of what they might do.
Yeah.
Because that line drive to second base might go up the hill against that.
Yeah. I was using Baseball Prospectus's 2017 run expectancy matrix. So I generalized when I was talking about their inherited and inherited runners, but certainly every inherited runner is not created equal, because the guy in third with no outs is a lot harder to prevent than the guy in first with two outs. So that was something I did consider, and I did weigh. So it wasn't just an overarching generalized formula. It was I had it down to Baseball Prospectus's specific values.
This is a more general question. As you showed with the baseball reference board, and particularly the runs allowed, it depends also on what teammates do, as opposed to the, you said, the fan graphs and fielding independent pitching, which doesn't depend on teammates. Also on your graph, you showed that on the offensive side, grounding into double plays, that's also depending on teammates. Do you know if the fan graphs version is totally player only and not dependent on teammates?
Well, I was generally focusing on pitching. I think it's reasonable to assume fan graphs is fixed since it's based off the independent pitching, which is generally just focusing on walks allowed to strike out.
Yeah, right. It doesn't depend on the teammates. I was wondering on their offensive parts also.
I personally didn't focus on fan graphs, but I know just based my knowledge of fielding independent pitching.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think it works.
Isn't there a basic problem in making this adjustment in that, first of all, given the nature of relief pitching, which is ever changing, and the fact that middle relievers are generally supporting Boswell, the most inconsistent part of any 25-man roster from day to day, week to week, month to month, year to year. Aren't you trying to maybe solve an unsolvable problem? And the work that you've done is significant, and I think that those of us that had the eye test with Ryan Madsen I'm wondering how exactly, you might be right, might just be purely looking back and have virtually no predictive value, which leads me to question, I guess, the value of any war
So it is really hard to boil, I guess, my findings down to do you have a problem in the predictive value? I think it's, again, it's more focusing on how many runs they did save relative to a replacement level player. But it's just overall, it's a difficult question to ask because lead pitchers, it's inherently tough. Cody Allen just signed 1 year for $9 million after having an ERA of about 5. He earned that money in the years prior. So I guess it's difficult to look at relievers given how volatile they are. Because, I mean, I followed the Red Sox this past year. It always felt like Craig Kimbrel was a pitcher with the ERA of 4 because it's very easy to take that one outing where you allow 2 runs, and then it takes countless outings to add it back up. So I don't really know if that answered your question, but it just, my findings hint that, at least in terms of Baseball Reference's WAR, there's a systematic devaluation for the value that in looking at impaired runners.
And by the way, just FYI, I've noticed that a lot of the commentators have been commenting on impaired runs allowed, certainly a lot more than in previous years. So obviously it does happen. It is rising in import.
Yeah, I think it was just nice still. It felt pretty fun as doing this research project to really, because I also do appreciate how commentators, there's just more public emphasis on impaired runners as a way of looking at relievers. I found it pretty fun to do this project and really start boiling these down and seeing just how different every impaired runner is. There are a lot of outlier examples where you really got to be careful, I guess, in how you handle your evaluation, how they handle the runner.
One more question.
Yep.
So, Jeff, let's say hypothetical, some team's GM calls you up and says, here's 2 middle relievers, we're thinking about signing them. How should we look at your statistic to decide between 2 of them, or should we use it right now? Because, or should we use it right now? I don't actually know where I was going to address that question.
Well, I guess in terms of if a GM called me up,
yeah.
hopefully I won't have that business, but I don't know. A lot of it is maybe looking at just some X factor. Maybe if you try to carry this over multiple years, seeing if some reliever, if this does hold a predictive value, some reliever seriously does have some